Now for the top story tonight, as you may know, Fox News has hired Governor Sarah Palin to do news analysis that has thrown the left-wing media into a conniption.
Isn't Sarah Palin going to work for Fox News like just a godsend to anybody who wants to have some comedy on the radio?
She had a pesky little problem with the truth. No irony that day these headlines came out. Fox News snatches her up.
Maybe she'll learn a lot being a pundit on Fox News, but at the time they picked her.
How could she be a pundit? She doesn't know anything.
Unfortunately, there's just going to be one more ignorant right-winger at Fox News.
Now, here's how dumb that comment is. The Factor beats CNN 5-1 at 8 p.m. And we expect that to increase with Sarah Palin on board. Somebody tell Mr. Begala. Here now is the governor whose best-selling book, Going Rogue, continues to dominate the bestseller lists across the country. At this point, you know, we talked about this last time you were in here. It's almost funny that these people feel that you're such a threat to them. It's almost amusing, is it not?
Well, I'm grinning today, and I'm so appreciative of the opportunity to get to work with you and the other team members here at Fox News to provide the fair and the balanced reporting and analysis that voters in this country deserve.
Well, obviously, folks are watching Fox News far more than they watch these pinheads that comment negatively on you. But it's the threat that I don't get. You're the governor of Alaska, the former governor of Alaska, former vice presidential candidate. You're a politician. You're a mom. You're an American. What's the threat? I'm not feeling it here, Governor. I'm not feeling the threat from you here. Tell me what the threat is.
Well, see, obviously, it's not about me. It's not about me personally, who I am from up there.
Yeah,
in
but
Alaska.
They're going after you personally.
They don't like the message. They don't like the common sense conservative solutions that I think I represent and I articulate as I explain what I believe are some solutions to the great challenges facing
it's
America.
True,
they don't like to hear it.
That's true, but there are a lot of conservative politicians giving that message, and none of them are as attacked personally as vehemently as you are. And that's just a fact. Now, President Obama's poll numbers sinking. I think it's the unemotional response to terror, as I said, and the health care debacle. Anything else in play?
Of course they're sinking. It was just a matter of time before more of that reflection of the people's uncomfortableness that they feel towards this administration is manifesting in these poll numbers. There is an obvious disconnect between President Obama and the White House, what they are doing to our economy and what they are doing in terms of not allowing Americans to feel as safe as we had felt, and people finally saying, you know, this is not the representative form of government that we thought that we had voted in. After a year's time, people are saying, no, we want the White House, we want President Obama to hear from us. We want these common sense solutions with health care, with jobs, with the economy, with the war on terror to be implemented so we can get back on the right track.
But isn't it true that no human being could lower the unemployment rate at this point? I mean, I don't like the massive spending. I think it's going to bankrupt the nation. But I'm telling myself, if Sarah Palin and John McCain were in, could they bring unemployment down under 10%? And I'm not sure you could.
If the question is, can any individual politician change the job forecast outlook? No, but what government can do is get out of the way of the private sector being able to seize opportunities to grow and to thrive and prosper and hire more people. You do that, a politician, a policy does that by reducing taxes on the job creators, by getting government out of the way of the private sector. Let's talk about health care for a minute. When we consider that the White House wants to take another 1/6 of our economy, take it from the private sector hands, take it over and put it in government's hands, that's another step towards greater unemployment numbers. It's another step towards greater growth of government, which is the wrong track.
Well, that's what they want. But remember, they won. They won on that. Everybody who voted for Barack Obama, if they were paying attention, knew he was a big government liberal. So, you know, the folks are getting what they deserve.
There were promises made, though, that he made that he is not keeping, obviously.
There are always promises. You know that.
It's a more glaring situation today, though, than we have seen in past administrations. There were such clear promises, such blatant promises.
Like C-SPAN going health care coverage?
C-SPAN, like a bipartisan approach
right.
to finding the solutions to health care.
That was pretty bad, I have to say. Do you
Those
know Nancy
bad.
Pelosi? Have you ever met her?
I met her once in the Capitol building. Yes.
Yeah, did
she
you
wouldn't got, remember me, but
she wouldn't. I think
no.
she'd remember you, Governor.
No.
But did you chat with her? Did you have any idea?
Chatted with her a little bit. Yes, she was leading a group of school children through on a tour, and I thought, well, that's nice that she has that time on her hands that she could do that.
Yeah, but the school children need to be led.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It was nice.
Do you think that she's a kook?
I think that she, too, is quite disconnected from what her constituents, too, are telling her. And constituents all over
this country. But she's a San Francisco liberal, but do you think she's actually crazy?
I doubt that her San Francisco constituents even are enamored with her policies and with the guidance that she is providing this country
today. Is she further to the left, in your opinion, than Barack Obama?
Perhaps so, yes.
Yeah. Yes. All right. Now, Harry Reid gets in trouble with the Negro dialect remark and the light skin color. What would you say? I'm Harry Reid, okay? And say, no, I'm not going to say that. No. Say, what would you say to me?
Well, obviously, those were, you can't defend those comments.
But he's sorry. He's sorry. Is that enough?
Well, he says he's sorry. That way of thinking is quite foreign to, I think, most Americans today. I come from.
Do you think it was a racist statement?
I come from a very diverse state. My family is diverse. I'm married to an Alaska Native. A lot of us don't think along those lines that somebody's skin tone would be criteria for a qualification for the presidency. So his thinking and his articulating of that thought is quite perplexing, is quite unfortunate, and
do you think it was
unacceptable.
Racist?
I don't believe that he's a racist, but I don't believe that Trent Lott was a racist either. And that double
standard.
No, we did
that last night, right.
I know, and that double standard is, and that hypocrisy is another reason why so many Americans are quite disgusted with the political games that are played really on both sides of the aisle, but in this case, on the left wing, what they are playing with this game of racism and kind of letting Harry Reid's comments slide, but having crucified Trent Lott for essentially along the same lines.
Last time you were here, I asked you about Iran, and that's coming down the pike now real fast. Yeah. I mean, this is this underreported story. We're keeping a very close eye on it. But in the next few weeks, Barack Obama's going to have to do something with Iran.
Yeah, he
is. What would you do?
Well, the time for talking about sanctions, I think we've passed that. Even the last couple of weeks, we have passed that. And we need to follow through on those financial terms that are favoring some Iranian businesses and Iranian regimes.
But you figure
regimes.
That they're doing that, right?
No, I don't think that they are doing it, or we perhaps would
you attack them?
Some...
Would you let Israel attack them?
I think that we can still head in that direction of the financial sanctions and the sanctions on petroleum.
Right, so
the
you haven't changed your opinion?
Projects. No, I haven't changed my opinion, except to say we've talked about it enough. You and I talked about
it. Yeah, we talked about it last time we were here.
Those weeks ago, and there has been no change except for change for the worse. So no, now the time for talking, that's enough. We want to make sure that we and our allies are following through now on
if
those
they don't
threats
do it,
of sanctions.
If they don't do it, though, should we attack? If the Iranians don't stop their nuclear program, should we attack?
I think that obviously we need to adhere to those sanctions, those threats that
All right,
we
so
have
So you're not ready to
first.
Say we got to get them if they don't?
An attack, a military attack, needs to be our very, very last option.
Right, but it's coming down. It's getting close.
Yeah.
The Israelis are getting very, very close.
Well, right. What I would like to see the Obama administration do, though, is convince Americans that they would be willing to do anything that needs to be done to protect America and her allies.
To start
preparing
them.
Israel. Absolutely. Okay. And we want to know that.
We're going to have more with the governor in a moment. We're going to hold her over because I do have some other foolish questions to ask her. And we appreciate your patience very much.